We've been looking at Peter's life through the lens of the Gospels and the book of Acts, but today we're going to shift to the two books that Peter himself wrote, his two epistles, 1st and 2nd Peter. These are letters that he wrote to the church, trying to encourage the early believers who he had led faithfully. But these letters would do so much more than that, as they would ultimately be part of our Bible for faithful Christians to read for generations to come. In the book of 1 Peter, he addresses a number of things, but one of the key things that he focuses on is how to live a holy life even in the midst of suffering. Now, Peter knew exactly what he was talking about here. By this point in his life, we believe that he had relocated to Rome, and this is when the Emperor Nero was in charge of the Roman Empire. If you know anything about Nero, you know that he was a tyrant, a brutal man who was famous for persecuting, torturing, and killing countless Christians. Nero's persecution of Christians intensified when there was a great fire in the city of Rome that destroyed large sections of the city. Interestingly, many historians believe that the fire was actually set by Nero himself. Now, why would he do something like that? Well, historians believe that Nero saw that the Roman economy was struggling, and so he wanted to stimulate it by having some new jobs be created. And by having sections of the city destroyed that were older, he was able to justify rebuilding them and thus creating a number of construction jobs. Problem is, some of his political enemies became aware of this, and they were going to hold him accountable. So Nero decided he needed a scapegoat, and he blamed Christians for setting fire to the city. Now, there was no reason why Christians would have done this, but this was Nero's claim, and he used this as an excuse to persecute the church. Christians were arrested and thrown into prison. They were taken to the Colosseum and forced to fight with lions, even gladiators. They were killed for sport. It was a terrible time. So Peter is living in an era like this, where these are the problems that the church is facing. And I know that we have our own challenges today, but when you think of it in those terms, we have it really good compared to what the early church had to deal with. So Peter challenges the church in the midst of all of this to be holy. It would have been easy to get distracted from this call to holiness because when we're suffering, we're hurting, and there's so many other things we could be focused on. But yet Peter calls them back to the core of what it means to be a follower of Jesus. Listen to what he says in chapter 1, verses 14 through 16. So you must live as God's obedient children. Don't slip back into your old ways of living to satisfy your own desires. You didn't know any better then. But now you must be holy in everything you do, just as God who chose you is holy. For the scriptures say, you must be holy because I am holy. That's a high standard, isn't it? God challenges us to be holy. Why? Because he himself is holy. It's not about what your neighbor does. It's not just about being a little better than you used to be. Those are nice, but the standard is not that. The standard is the Lord. And when we talk about holiness, sometimes we get this confused. Sometimes we look at holiness as this just set of do's and don'ts, just a moral code. And certainly holiness involves obedience and being faithful to live according to God's word. That's true. However, it's more than just that. It's not just obedience for the sake of obedience. That's legalism, not holiness. God doesn't call us to legalism because legalism could never save us. Obedience is the outcome of holiness. It's a result of holiness. Holiness itself is all about a relationship of love with the living God. You see, when you love the Lord with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, you want to live according to his standards. It's not just because you're afraid that something bad's going to happen if you don't. It's because you love the Lord and you want to honor him. You want to obey him. You want to do the things that please him. It's kind of like another significant relationship in your life, maybe a great friendship or a marriage or a dating relationship. If you think about how you treat that person, do you do things because you're afraid they're going to punish you? Well, hopefully not. That's not a good reason at all. You want to do things because you love them and you care about them and they mean so much to you. So when you see an opportunity to do something kind for them, you do it because you love them. And when you know something bugs them, you try not to do it because you understand that that might hurt them or that might cause a problem in the relationship. And that relationship matters to you more than that thing that you were going to do that they wouldn't appreciate. That's a simple illustration of what holiness is all about. But when we understand how much God loves us, and when we love Him faithfully, it's a natural thing to want to live the way that He calls us to live. Are there areas of your life where God is calling you to grow deeper in holiness? Maybe there's something that God is calling you to do. It's a way that you could love Him better, and you know that you should, but you just haven't been doing it yet. Maybe it's some more time in your devotions, or maybe it's a way of showing love to one of God's children, or something else that God's been laying on your heart. Or maybe there's something that you need to get out of your life, a sin that God has been convicting you of, or a habit that's just not helping, something like that. I'm wondering if you'd be willing to share that with your group today, if you're comfortable. You don't have to, but if you feel led, I invite you to do that. In fact, your group could even pray for you as you talk about these things. Because here's the deal. All of us are on this journey together. None of us fully get it. We're all striving to grow more and more like Jesus, more and more in love with Jesus, and we support each other as we do that.